So good morning. If I could get folks' attention. So for those of you who I don't know, my name is Matt Goldenberg, and I'm a member of a faculty member in the department, and I'm also the section chief of psychiatric emergency services at Yale New Haven Hospital. I'm here today in my capacity as the co-chair of the department's Global Mental Health Program Council. My co-chair, Ayanna Jordan, regrets that she's not able to be here today. But we're, as a council and as a department, really excited to welcome Dr. Brandon Kohrt for our annual grand rounds on global mental health. I'm just going to give a short introduction to Dr. Kohrt and then turn the stage over to him. Dr. Kohrt grew up in Pennsylvania and went west for college at University of Southern California. It was there, he told me, that he made the fateful decision to do a study abroad program in Nepal, which is where he spent the better part of the last 20 years working. His college honors thesis was an examination of somatization in a Nepali village, so he sort of knew early on that he was interested in the intersection of in studying mental health in that area. After college, he went on to obtain a master's degree and then an MD and PhD in anthropology from Emory. He had told me last night that he had really wanted to come to Yale for his residency, but family obligations kept him in Atlanta for the first 2 years of his residency, and then he completed his training at GW in Washington, D.C. While he was a resident, he founded and directed a mental health clinic for Bhutanese refugees in Atlanta. Since 2013, he's been on the faculty at Duke with appointments in psychiatry and anthropology and at the Duke Global Health Institute. He's an emerging leader in the field of global mental health. He's authored nearly 70 peer-reviewed papers and a slew of other scholarly work. He also has been involved in 5 documentary films, including writing the award-winning Returned Child Soldiers of Nepal's Maoist Army. He edited the book Global Mental Health, Anthropological Approaches, which last year won the Creative Scholarship Award from the Society for the Study of Psychiatry and Culture. During residency, he was a Laughlin Fellow of the American College of Psychiatrists. In 2015, he won the Michael Little Early Career Award presented by the Human Biology Association for distinguished early career contribution to the anthropologic study of human biology. In addition to his work in Nepal, Dr. Kohrt has been a consultant to the Carter Center's mental health program in Liberia. He's also been involved in projects and written about mental health in Uganda, Haiti, Ethiopia, and South Africa. It's our great pleasure to welcome Dr. Kohrt to New Haven.
Thanks, Matt. Appreciate it. Thank you. Good morning. I think everything Matt said is true, especially the part about really wanting to come to Yale and only having one very significant life partner who said, maybe not right now. So it's a pleasure to be here today, though. I really enjoy the vibrant community here. And this all the interest in global mental health. So it's a real privilege to speak with you all. I think it's a pretty safe bet to say that we're all here because of an interest in wanting to transform lives through promoting mental health and reducing mental disorders. One of the most powerful impacts on mental health at a population level are humanitarian emergencies, whether that is epidemic outbreaks, natural disaster, war, terrorism, and other crises. These have powerful effects on children, on adults, and intergenerational effects on communities. I chose to work in this area not only to provide immediate relief for populations affected by humanitarian emergencies, but also really as an opportunity to change mental health systems. And so I hope that by the time I'm done today, you can take away this example in Nepal really as a proof of concept for ways in which we can change policy, we can increase human capital, and we can actually transform services in the wake of humanitarian emergencies. Obviously, to do this kind of work and transform systems, this is not something done alone by any means, and I've had the real privilege of over a decade working with a Nepali non-governmental organization, TPO, or Transcultural Psychosocial Organization Nepal, and a lot of the work here is in collaboration with them, as well as my 2 longtime collaborators, Mark Jordans and Vitse Toll, as well as what Matt mentioned, relationships with the Carter Center in Liberia and a number of other associations. no conflicts of interest. My primary funding right now is a K01 and R21, and our work has received funding from a number of donors. A lot of the work I'm talking about today is actually funded by the United Kingdom, Department for International Development, and the European Union. Nearly 2 years ago, on April 25th, there was a 7.8 magnitude earthquake that hit Nepal, just west of the Kathmandu Valley in the area of Gorkha. Within days, more than 9,000 people had died, and thanks to a second earthquake that happened just 2 weeks later, just east of the valley, the death toll reached almost 10,000. More than 500,000 people were homeless, and 8 million people lost access to water, food, transportation, education, and healthcare. This is just one example of devastating humanitarian emergencies that affect people around the world. And it's crucial that we find ways to rapidly intervene and also to provide support over the long term. Just to give you a sense of how much this can transform someone's life, this was a village that was on a mountainside in an area called Sindel Polchuk, just east of Kathmandu. And the entire village was swept away down the mountain. People who had been out of their homes survived, and the rest were lost. Many communities throughout Nepal were affected in this way. This also really hit home for me personally. As Matt mentioned, I've been working in Nepal since 1996, many close friends. This young man here, Puru, I've known since about 2006, and he has a young son there. His name is Hardik. At the time of the earthquake, he was on one side of his home. He rented a third story in Kathmandu, and his wife and five-year-old son were on the other side. They felt the building began to shake, and within just a few seconds, Puru knew that an earthquake was coming. He tried to run across the room to grab his wife and his son, and the ground just fell out. It just completely collapsed. The whole family fell three floors. Puru eventually dug his way out of the rubble, completely covered in the soot from the concrete that had crumbled. Miraculously, his son and his wife were both alive and physically unharmed. And many, many people survived the earthquake just as Puru and his family did. But not surprising to any of us, Puru's son stopped speaking, started wetting the bed, absolutely, positively refused to go inside any buildings. 3 months later, 4 months later, he still wanted to remain outside. In many ways, his mother shared the same feelings and also did not want to go indoors. It took many months to begin to get Puru's son to start speaking again, but thanks to the programs that I'll describe in a few minutes, he was able to get services, and I'll tell you a little bit in the end about how he's doing today. The WHO estimates that about 10% of people who are affected by natural disasters will have a psychological problem of some kind. If we think of 8 million people, that means that over 800,000 are going to have a need of services in some way in Nepal. So what are the services, what are the standards of care and the best practices to respond in an emergency like this? Well, we can't think just about the emergency response itself. As we know, the mental health consequences of trauma are not just in the immediate aftermath, but these can go on for months, years, and even, as I mentioned before, intergenerationally. So this is an example of the emergency response cycle that we can use to think about intervening. So while there is an emergency, we must always keep in mind that there's a pre-emergency condition. What is the existing health system that's in place? What are the resources that are there? Before somebody jumps on a plane from New Haven or Washington, D.C. or Durham and flies over to Nepal, what's already existing there? And then, as we're beginning to work on emergency, we need to think about the post-emergency conditions, and then ultimately, how can we lead to sustainable mental health changes? So today, I'm going to walk you through this cycle. And over the 20 years of working in Nepal, we've gone through this cycle nearly three times. The first was a decade-long communist revolution, the People's War, that happened from 1996 to 2006. This was when I began my work and worked a lot with child soldiers. About a decade after that, there was a series of massive floods that affected Nepal and northern India as well. And we had to respond to that crisis. And then 8 years after, 7 years after that, we have the major earthquakes. So what I want to do is be able to show you how at each moment we engaged in emergency response, but then use that to inform health systems building with throughout the country, and the kind of cumulative effect of these health systems over the past 20 years, as well as our changes in responding on emergency response. And we hope that this can be a proof of concept for other types of ongoing disasters around the world. From a conceptual level, Matt mentioned I also have training in anthropology, so we always want to have some concepts there as well. There are three pieces that have really come to the surface as important when thinking about emergency responses. And the first is that individuals are not just their traumatic experience. They are more than that one moment of the really awful thing that happened to them. So how do we think about individuals with their personal history, but also the history of communities? Often when an intervention comes in, especially when you get lots of money all of a sudden, we ignore all of the existing resources and of all the kind of prior traumas that may be even more important than the acute trauma. So how do we think about persons in history when we do emergency response? The second is to think about persons in mind. We can't always apply the same exact interventions across settings and across disasters. We have to look at what are the local concepts of understanding the self, of suffering, of social relationships. In anthropology, we often refer to this as ethnopsychology. And I'll give you examples about how we incorporate that in our work. And the last part is that I'm really talking about collective traumatic experiences. These are not singly experienced traumatic events. So we always have to think about the persons in society. And at times, actually treating an individual may be at odds with the overall benefit of society. So how do we think about collective ways of healing in response to collective traumas? There's been a great boon in the field of global mental health. Many of you in the area are familiar with the work of Vikram Patel, who's really championed this. If we look back at this point, almost exactly 20 years ago, Bob Desjarlais led a book with Arthur Kleinman, Leon Eisenberg, and Byron Good up at Harvard to map out the situation of world mental health. And that preceded the 2001 publication from the World Health Organization that was the first time they actually took on mental health as a topic area. And this led shortly thereafter to the Lancet series in 2007, which was replicated in 2011, and now we have the Lancet 2017 commission coming out shortly on global mental health. More specifically, when we think about the resources and guidance for emergency response, there are really three key documents. The first are the ISC guidelines. The IS guidelines are developed by the WHO, UNICEF, CARE, Save the Children, United Nations High Commission for Refugees, and it's collaborative guidance to really say what are the best practices, what are the manners in which we can deliver services. This came in large part out of the tsunami in 2005. In 2005, in Sri Lanka, Indonesia, southern India, it was a very haphazard response in terms of delivering services. A lot of people parachuted in, provided some services, and then left. And so these organizations got together and said, we need a different approach. In 2013, WHO released Building Back Better, and that provides a lot of the framework for this talk. And the idea there is you don't just do immediate responses, but how do you leave the country with an actually stronger health system than when you came in? And most recently, in 2015, the WHO released the Mental Health Global Action Program for humanitarian interventions. In 2008, there was the MHGAP, or the Standard Guide for Primary Care Work in Low-Resource Settings, and this is a more specific humanitarian version that adds on things like PTSD, traumatic grief, and acute stress disorder. So the overall framework is that in an emergency, it's not just clinical care. You can't just do the top of this pyramid here, but you actually have an overall framework that covers all of these different levels. And if you don't effectively integrate each different piece, you're going to have an ineffective response, and also you're not going to have positive long-term benefits. So whereas much of the work that we do is up here at Individualized Clinical Services, there's also an increasing attention that to be a global mental health practitioner, you also need to be able to help coordinate, design, and evaluate all these other pieces as well. So the second piece would be more focused psychosocial support. This could be case management. This could be brief psychological treatments that could be delivered by non-specialists. Then at the next level, you have overall community strength building. As I mentioned before, these are collective traumas, so aspects of collective healing are very important. And then at the bottom is the idea that you need to integrate psychosocial thinking into livelihoods, into having clean water, into how you set up latrines in a safe way to, say, protect against gender-based violence. So really, you need this whole platform for an effective response. As I mentioned before, one of my colleagues, Vitsay Toll, did a review in 2011. And what he found is, unfortunately, the vast majority of our evidence in our studies are really at the upper levels here. We have very little data on what works best in these lower areas. And sadly, even in the entering 6 years, we haven't progressed very well in terms of more studies on that. But ultimately, what we would argue, my colleagues and I in Nepal, is that you can't just evaluate any one of these pieces in isolation. We really need complex trials that can get at how this works best when all of the pieces are integrated together, which will be some of the models that I show you today. All right, so let's start with our first experience. What was the mental health system like during the period of the People's War? What was the emergency response? And then how did that lead to system strengthening that carried forward to other projects? In Nepal, few people know this, but there was actually a pretty severe civil war that happened for 10 years. It was a Maoist revolution. In the middle of this, the king was assassinated. That hit the news more. That was around 2001. And at the end of this 10-year civil war, the actually king was overthrown, and so that Nepal was no longer a Hindu monarchy. There was widespread abductions, torture, violence throughout the country, and there were also large numbers of child soldiers that were abducted. And so I'll tell you a little bit about some of the intervention we developed for them. Now, the key thing to think about in this process is that all of these traumatic events are occurring within a history of a mental health system, of ways of healing, ways of understanding the self, and that those really need to be incorporated for an effective emergency response. So this is a quote that I often show that came from Srinivas Murthy. And he wrote in the early 2000s that the exposure, in this case to trauma or humanitarian emergencies, of large population groups, mostly having no mental health problems prior to the exposure, and the subsequent development in a significant proportion of the population of a variety of psychiatric symptoms and disorders, represents both a challenge and opportunity for psychiatrists. So this is, I hold up as an example of this ahistorical approach. It's the assumption that in these places like Nepal, we kind of have this glorified image of Sherpas and mountains and trekking, that everything was just fine, and then a war came and everything fell apart and everybody was significantly affected. And that's just not the case. We need to look at what the history shows us about a place to best define effective interventions. So my work in 1996 started with actually studying traditional healing. This was a temple in southeastern Nepal where I lived for a couple of months. And what you saw there was that individuals in the community were often chained. They were brought by their families. And then they would go through a prayer healings form of kind of exorcism to recover from the mental illness. Often people with bipolar disorder, schizophrenia, as well as a number of other conditions. And this is really the dominant form of healing that was going on at the time. This is another image of a shaman there. And many individuals were just locked up, kept away. At the time, you only had about one psychiatrist per million people. So very, very limited specialized mental health resources. That said, there may in fact be high numbers of mental health problems because there are so few resources available. And so what we did is in one community around 1999-2000, a community actually where Jordan Sloshower, one of the residents, worked, a place called Jumla, we looked at studying depression as well as anxiety. And we found very high rates, about 3 out of 10 people with moderate indication on the BDI for treatment, and about one out of four for anxiety. This was even before this Maoist civil war hit the area. At the time, there were kind of rumors and rumblings, but there had been no attacks, there'd been no violence, no kids abducted from schools. And this was the rate of mental health problems at that time. So I lived there for a year, we did this study, and then I left at the end of 2000 and couldn't go back. The violence just got too bad. Within 1 year of leaving, the town center had been bombed, there was a major army camp up there. Many of my colleagues who had some experience in the medical field were actually abducted by the Maoists so they could provide medical care for them. You also saw children being abducted and forced into the Maoist army, as well as the police coming in and accusing many people of being sympathizers to the Maoists and then torturing them. So I went back in 2007, very relieved. Many of the people with whom I worked were still alive and their families were okay, but they were all, of course, impacted by this awful experience. And so we were, thanks to a great group of research assistants, able to meet almost 92% of the individuals we interviewed in 2000. So we were able to finally actually look at people before and after traumatic experience, the same exact people in collective trauma. And so this is what we found and then published a few years later in the British Journal of Psychiatry. What you see is that when you control for aging of the population, even though there were very high rates of depression, went from 30% up to about 40%, that this could actually all be controlled for just by the aging of the population. So if you had just flown in after the war was over and looked at these numbers, you'd be like, oh, this awful Maoist revolution, which was awful. But you would falsely attribute that just to the war itself. Now, we did see, to be fair, that there was definitely an increase in anxiety amongst the population. But you really need this type of research to understand that a lot of the burden of the mental health problems in disaster settings, in humanitarian emergencies, is because of all of the chronic ongoing problems. High rates of physical health problems that are untreated, high rates of interpersonal violence, gender discrimination, ethnic discrimination. And we can't just attribute all of this to the traumatic experience that makes the news. The most effective interventions, therefore, will be long-term interventions that are about strengthening mental health services as well as other forms of social change. So what does this risk? Well, I think it risks the idea of the erasure of history. Just like a disaster, this is an example from the earthquake, can destroy buildings, disasters in our consciousness can also destroy the idea that people have a history before that disaster came. So we really advocate, as we consult to folks in Liberia, Uganda, other parts of the world affected by similar things, first and foremost, where does this disaster, where does this emergency fit in the picture of history? So just kind of the takeaway here is that people are embedded in their histories preceding trauma and that should shape post-emergency mental health services. So what did we do? At that time, I joined in 2006, but there had been a Nepali non-governmental organization, TPO Nepal, that had formed in 2005. And we started out at the time about 13 people in one little concrete room in Nepal, mostly working with UNICEF and Save the Children to design services for these children that had been affected by the war. And over the past 10 years, as I kind of culminate in the earthquake response, we grew from about 15 people to nearly 400 at the peak last year of the earthquake response, and went from a budget of about 35,000 to last year it was actually 2.5 million. So we've really grown our capacity to be able to respond to these types of challenges. So what we did at that time was to really ground our work in the combination of research and service, the idea that science and service should not be separable. How do you design evidence-based approaches, and how do you always make sure that your knowledge production translates into care, clinical care? So we first looked to see amongst these child soldiers that UNICEF had hired us to help understand and then integrate back to their communities, what were their mental health problems? Our first question was, we can't just assume that being a child soldier is worse than being a civilian in that community, because civilians often saw lots of violence when the Nepal army came in and raped women. We also saw lots of gender and ethnic discrimination. The Maoists, in some ways, were seen as almost a haven from all the problems that were going on in the communities. The Maoists were very strict regulating against sexual violence. The Maoists also had very clear codes of integrating across caste and ethnicity. So first, we had to start with the idea of, are child soldiers really in need of special services? Well, despite some of the Maoist ideology, we did find that they clearly had more mental health problems than other kids in the community after they came home after the war, so we had to design interventions to address that. You've increasingly heard in the field of global mental health about the idea of task shifting or task sharing, and so in the mid-2000s, this was our attempt at trying to do that as the field was just beginning to grow. So what was the existing resource and what was the intervention that they could deliver? Well, there were lots of NGO workers being deployed after the war. So what we did was we developed a 28-day curriculum for people who had some experience with kids. They could be a social worker in the loosest sense of the term, basically an NGO worker or a teacher or just an advocate for kids in the community. And we trained them for 28 days on some very basic community-wide interventions. The idea that we're not going to be able to train them for TFCBT or some specialized skill to deliver to the kids. And also, because this was very much of a communal experience, we thought that the intervention should also take on a communal form. So the four main pieces were sensitizing adults to the experience of kids who have gone through traumatic events, not just focusing on child soldiers that could marginalize them, but really think broadly about the impact of war on children. Then we did a lot of work with discretion groups. We found that many of the child soldiers who came back home weren't allowed in their schools, they weren't allowed to sleep inside with their families, and that teachers were really community leaders. as long as teachers were discriminating, everybody else in the community basically had felt permission to do the same thing. So we wanted to make sure that we could change the teacher's behavior. So we focused a lot actually on the teacher's anxiety and trauma symptoms. And by doing that, they were much better able to then engage with the child soldiers and help to rebuild the schools and the sense of community. Also working with parent and caregivers to help them with the reintegration. And then ultimately, the idea of getting the kids just involved in day-to-day activities. If you could get a former child soldier and a civilian kid on the same side in an athletic event or a spelling bee or a song competition, those relationships would begin to form. So we couldn't do a randomization of this, in part because of the ethics working with UNICEF, and there was no other kind of option at the time. So what we did instead was we compared the child soldiers and the civilian kids before they received the intervention, and then after, with the idea being that we see group differences before the intervention, can we find that those group differences wash out after 12 months of this community-based care? And this is what we found, that in all areas, the child soldiers were statistically not different from the community kids after this 1 year of intervention. Many other things were going on in terms of political restructuring, but this at least points us towards the idea that some of these collective type programs may be an effective way to help kids recover and reintegrate. So prior to this, if we look at this cycle, we're in a country that has no enacted mental health policy, fewer than 20 psychiatrists, general lack of psychological services, and one or two validated scales, the GHQ and the BDI. After it, we actually had a 6-month counseling program to kind of develop somewhat semi-specialists, and we had this month-long community-based curriculum, as well as a whole number of validated scales to help improve the system. So it wasn't a big leap forward, but it was a nice small step given our limited resources at the time that could then be incorporated as things went forward. So what we did was mostly in the INGO and NGO sector help to then make these the standards of care for UNICEF for Save the Children. So rather than reinventing the wheel, this stuff, you know, had promise, and so we were able to do that. In addition, what we found was that the 6-month counseling had general appeal for survivors of sex trafficking, for individuals who are affected by ethnic and caste discrimination. So we began to apply an emergency developed response to more broad ongoing chronic psychosocial problems. So the second phase was in relation to these massive floods, the Kohrt floods that happened around 2008 in Nepal and northern India. What we really tried to do at this point was to work with other NGOs and say, we need to standardize some of the practices here. And this was just after the IASC guidelines I mentioned before came out. Psychological first aid tools were now being made available by the WHO. So what we did was we developed Nepali versions of Guidance on Response, the IAS guidelines. We developed a Nepali version of psychological first aid, and then another tool called the HESPER, which is a humanitarian needs assessment. And that was a standardized way to get information across populations. One of the big problems is this community says it has X number of problems, this community says it has X number of problems. If we don't have a common scale, we can't really judge where the resources are and where the risks are. The other activity that really started to grow at that time in our organization and more broadly in global mental health was not just thinking about emergency response, but also general health system strengthening. So this was key as TPO was growing and in terms of actually then informing what we did after the earthquake. So as I mentioned at the beginning, we got a lot of funding from the UK Department for International Development, the European Union. So PRIME is a 5-country project based out of South Africa, but also running in Uganda, Nepal, Ethiopia, and India. And Emerald is a similar program, but also includes Nigeria as well. And these were really health system strengthening programs. So what we did a lot of was taking the MHGAP, this WHO tool, to use that and try and develop contextualized training programs for primary care workers and community health workers. So this is an example of the MHGAP. Many of you have seen this. So we developed a Nepali version of this, as well as a Nepali version of a training. So whereas the MHGAP recommends about a 5-day training, we said in Nepali context, this is not going to work by any means. So we, you know, still had a not exorbitant amount of time, but increased it to a 10-day training. And then we also integrated it with the idea of a package of care. If you only train primary care workers, but the rest of the system isn't changing, how effective do you expect your intervention to be? So we had to do a lot of advocacy around drug supply management. If you train folks, but the SSRIs, the antipsychotics aren't available, this is not going to be effective. Also work around health management information systems, or HMIS, to help the government actually track this information, as well as overall getting supervision systems in place. Not this idea of kind of train and hope. We come in, we train your folks, and we hope this is going to work out. See you later. So really actually having local resources that are going to be around for long-term supervision. And then also, in addition to the health organization, health facility, really doing community-based programs as well. So ultimately having a broader package of care that somebody could then replicate throughout other parts of Nepal or other low-resource countries. All of this was done very much in partnership with the Ministry of Health. The idea being that WHO now promotes in the Building Back Better that you can't do this stuff in isolation of the existing infrastructure. As challenged and limited and fraught as these systems may be, when any INGO or NGO leaves, the government is still around. So actually, can you change government policies and government resources? And the other idea was to actually get certifications available. So if we're going to train individuals who are non-specialists in some of these things, they also need some status within the community. So actually having government certification was very important as well. And so this is an example of a Nepali-based community psychosocial training manual that if somebody goes through it, they can get certified for the government health system. The other part that has really been a challenge and we've worked on for a while is often when we think about global mental health, the idea is really around supply side issues. The idea of we just need more psychiatrists, we just need more psychologists, or if we get primary care workers to be able to do mental health treatment, everything will be just fine. It ignores the demand side factors. We found in Prime, not too surprisingly, that even as we really bolstered the mental health system, people weren't coming in for care. In some cases it was stigma, not surprising. But in many cases, it was just a lack of mental health literacy. The idea that this is something you can treat, that you can get care for. In many cases, it's witchcraft or possession. And so people just think, well, that's not something that a doctor would treat. One thing you can do is you could go house to house with, say, the PHQ-9, and if somebody scores above that, send them in for depression. It's not super effective. And even in high resource settings, the number of false positives can overburden the health system. So we've developed a very novel approach to be able to get people into care and have now replicated this in a number of countries. So this is called the CIDT, or Community Informant Detection Tool. And it's built around the idea of, if you're going to have community health workers, in many cases who are illiterate, doing assessments, you can't have a checklist. So it really uses the idea of prototypes. So we have a little story about Ram or about Sita who's having a mental health problem, maybe depression, maybe psychosis. And it really just describes what the experience would be. So that now a community health worker has that prototype in their mind of here's what an individual looks like who has X problem. And then, of course, using a lot of pictures. So what you see here, for example, are about the 9 different symptoms associated with depression. So we trained community health volunteers, traditional healers, and even community mothers groups on these tools, one for psychosis, one for depression, one for alcohol, one for epilepsy, and one for child mental health problems. And we found that they then sent people in for care. They were able to go not house to house, but they knew from their own work, from maybe their antenatal postnatal care, from TB programs, from vaccination programs, they knew who in the community had problems. And this was an easy way to kind of trigger, oh yeah, you know, Bir Bahadur down the street, he looks just like this person who has psychosis. I didn't know that he could get care. Now I'm going to refer him. So what we found was that about 6-7 out of 10 individuals who were given these CIDT forms actually sought care. So it was relatively effective, almost as effective as a screener. And from them, the accuracy of those tools was also about 7 out of 10. So you have a little bit of excess in terms of burden on the primary care system, but overall, this was a great people to get in, and many of those individuals who weren't CIDT positive still had other mental health or physical health problems that they benefited from entering care. The other part was to not just have mental health system development be about medications, but really try to find ways to feasibly deliver psychosocial treatments and psychological treatments. recently in Lancet in December, there were two groundbreaking papers published from the Premium Program, which is a welcome-funded trust program to Sangath and Vikram Patel, with the HAP and the CAP. HAP is a behavioral activation modified version for depression, and CAP is basically a simplified motivational interviewing. The CAP had mixed results, but some promising aspects, but the HAP was relatively effective in terms of being a simplified behavioral activation to treat depression when delivered by non-specialists in the community. So we're using those same manuals and same approaches for auxiliary nurse midwives and other paramedical people in the community to deliver psychological treatments. This didn't come out great, but the message is that in a recent meta-analysis and systematic review of all of the common mental disorder non-specialist treatments, it's coming out in a few months, we found a relatively decent effect size of about 0.46 for depression and 0.47 for trauma. So if any of you have seen the, I think it's the Hoon JAMA review, they found relatively similar results when specialist services were delivered in high-income countries. I think some of them got higher up into the 0.6. But still, this is enough for us to be able to advocate to governments to say, this works, help us to initiate these services. Okay. The other thing that we started developing and has now been very important after the earthquake is that there's this increasing recognition, especially with the 2014 WHO report, of suicide being a major problem in South and East Asia. Incredibly high rates in communities almost as high as those of Native Americans in the US. Nepal especially has a high rate, some estimates as high as 28 or even 30 per 100,000. So what we decided to do was to look at what are other psychological treatments that could be delivered by non-specialists in these settings. So DBT came up, DBT being an evidence-based, you know, self-harm intervention. The other thing that was appealing to us when looking across interventions was DBT is ostensibly based on Eastern concepts of thinking, ideas of the dialectic, ideas of mindfulness. So we thought, well, this is kind of like taking a treatment that had been adapted from one culture, done in a different culture, back to the original culture. So what we've started to do is to develop a Nepali skills-based DBT curriculum. And this uses some of the ethno-psychological concepts that we've worked with in Nepal that make it very easy from a psychoeducation standpoint to explain what we're doing in DBT. And also the interpersonal effectiveness component is very important because a lot of the suicides that we're seeing in Nepal, but also in India and China, especially for women, aren't in the instance of depression. It's often impulsivity in the context of domestic violence and other interpersonal stressors. So we felt that this would be a good intervention to try out. And this is a case study and is one multiple case series. And what we find, our primary outcome was difficulties in emotion regulation, was that these gradually dropped over about a 10 session intervention. And in that process, we see the increasing adoption of the ways of coping that are intended for DBT. So it seems to hold some promise for delivery in Nepal. The other thing we did and are using in a number of countries now is the problem that so much training goes on, but these trainings aren't evaluated. We have no idea when somebody's getting trained in basic evaluation and let's say pharmacologic management, or trained in a generalized psychosocial service, or problem solving, or BA, or MI, or DBT. We just have no idea what they're doing. So we wanted to come up with a tool that could be used cross-culturally to at least get at the common factors. To say, okay, regardless of which approach you're using, and all of these are being used increasingly in global mental health, are there some basic things that we could measure pre and post training? Then you could add on maybe a specific fidelity piece for your different interventions. So working with colleague Mark Jordans, Vikram Patel, we went through a four-step process. First of going through all of the common factors rating tools, I think we found that there were maybe 1,081 different unique items across them. Then we ranked relevance in a low-income cross-cultural setting. From there, we then did piloting of the tool using counselors, not only in Nepal, but also Liberia, Uganda, now using it in Sri Lanka and South Africa as well. Then we tried to see the feasibility of actually administering this, what the inter-rater reliability is. And we came up with a modestly good tool. So it gets at different things like nonverbal communication, verbal communication skills, rapport building, empathy, fostering feelings of hope. So this has been a good way for us to now actually evaluate when the government does a training, when an NGO does a training, to be able to see, yes, you're in a multiple choice answers may get better, but if your therapeutic skills don't actually improve, how effective was that training? So the second concept I said that was important, kind of cross-cutting all of these things, is the idea of mind. And what we found is in Nepal that unless you understand the ethnopsychology, it's very hard to explain to a provider or to a potential client why you are doing things such as psychological services, psychological treatments. Well, in Nepal, there's a complicated but very interesting construction of how one views the self. On the one side, you have this idea of the heart-mind. And the heart-mind is something that everybody has a heart-mind. The heart-mind is what is really kind of unique to you. It's your desires, your wishes, the people that you love in your life, the people that you care about. But there's another element, which is the brain-mind, kind of located physically in the brain. And this is more about social control. So somebody that has problems in the heart-mind might cry a lot, might worry a lot. But it's people that have brain-mind problems that are seen as aggressive, as potentially violent, as out of control. The reason this work became really important is that we were evaluating some of these trauma interventions that were going on, and we found that nobody was showing up for them. And when we began to look at it, they were all translating trauma, basically, as shock to the brain-mind, which, not surprisingly, given these social control issues, was very stigmatizing. So nobody wanted to say that my brain-mind was shocked. So we said, well, isn't trauma really about having bad memories? Isn't trauma about losing the desire to participate in daily life, losing the desire to engage with your friends and loved ones? What if we reframe traumatic experiences in terms of heart-mind? So we did this for adults and for kids and found that it was much more effective. It normalized the experience. So this was really important in terms of how we fashioned the interventions, especially the psychological treatments. This actually led to the KO1 research that I'm doing right now, which is, even though we have MHGAP as a decent tool to be able to deliver mental health services in primary care, most primary care workers, not unlike the US, don't actually want to deliver mental health services. They find it stigmatizing, they found it complicated, they find it burdensome. So what we've said is, well, it's really about changing some of these reflections, some of the motivation and the attitudes. So we're using the evidence-based practice of social contact or social engagement. So we have individuals who have mental illness in various states of recovery, and we teach them kind of a photographic narrative. It's a technique called photo voice. And what they do is they're now co-facilitators in the trainings to be able to help people understand what mental health is, that it's treatable, and reframe a lot of this idea of brain-mind dysfunction that's incurable, that's out of control, really in terms of heart-mind problems that are on a continuum that many people could have. And our initial results are rather promising, at least in terms of attitudes. We find that individuals who have this social contact piece have lower levels of stigma right after the training and about 3 months later at supervision. And so we're now also looking to see if these attitudinal changes also associated with higher ENACT scores, higher competency on common factors, as well as more patients coming and better outcomes for those patients. So this brings us at high speed up to the earthquake. And this is really important because we can't just talk about the earthquake and suddenly jumping in and responding. We have to think about all of the things that had already been done and how we built upon those to respond. So the earthquake happened April 25th. And immediately there were global responses. International Medical Corps, who is one of, disclosure, one of our main donors, made $15 million just in a few days from Facebook. American Nepal Medical Foundation, thanks to former Yale student, now psychiatrist, Bibhav Acharya, was able to do some massive fundraising. And many other organizations that are the common players also, of course, went out to provide resources. There was also a very, very important local response. So what you saw is that it took NGOs, a lot of time to get in place and to begin to deliver services. So what you would see is that shopkeepers would be handing out ramen noodles that weren't going to go bad to everybody in the community just because people couldn't get food, people couldn't get back into their houses. People were sharing spaces together, all living cramped up. And there was no rioting. There was no violence. People were sharing and caring for one another. And you also saw a lot of individuals in Kathmandu whose houses weren't destroyed, who actually still had access to resources, driving out to these rural areas, clearing the roads and then bringing rice and other resources to people. So it was a very, very important, massive internal support system before anything else got in place. So anybody that does this work, not going to be surprising, but I always just need to emphasize it. Our very first effort, our very first activity before any of the programming was just to make sure that our own staff were safe. We couldn't, with our large staff, just go out and start delivering programs if they themselves weren't okay. We had staff members who were living in buses whose houses had been destroyed. We had staff members, of course, who had injured or lost relatives. So we helped work with those individuals, provide care for them before asking them to participate in other activities. The other thing was, there were so many aftershocks because of this earthquake. I had no appreciation of aftershocks. I mean, you didn't really hear about them in Haiti so much. But there were 200,000 aftershocks within 1 year of the earthquake, and 400 of those were over a 4 magnitude on the Richter scale. Even a year ago, when I was in southern Nepal, so about, you know, over 100 kilometers away, I was still feeling aftershocks. And so people were in a constant state of anxiety. So many of the offices that I went to, they had signs up and they said, please do not put your phones on vibrate. It makes me think there's an aftershock going on. So people just really wanted to be able to feel calm and feel safe. This is also very interesting, a little bit of an aside, from an in vivo exposure standpoint. On the one hand, it's bad having lots of aftershocks, but in some way, does that actually help people get desensitized? So what we had to do is we moved the entire office outside. Wrapped the Wi-Fi routers up to trees, had everything wired, so the only thing you had to go inside for were bathrooms, and even set up, slightly, discreet ways to actually go to the bathroom outside if you were that concerned. But these were just really, crucial to begin before doing any other activities. The next thing was, and I'm actually indebted to a lot of the folks in the room here, is that we had a multi-university immediate desk review. And this is what WHO now recommends for any humanitarian emergency. It says, wait, before you jump in and do things, what is the existing evidence base? What are the resources? So Jordan Sloshauer, Kristen McLean, Anna Fiskin, who used to be here, were all very helpful within days, helping to compile over 200 different articles, manuals, and other resources for us to provide a brief 3-page executive summary combined with a 200-page report to give to all of the NGOs and other organizations coming over to help guide their activities, help educate, what's going to be stigmatizing, what are the resources already in place. So that was a very important contribution. The next then was through IMC. We did a qualitative needs assessment. What were people feeling? What were they experiencing? What resources were available to them? As well as a quantitative epidemiological survey. So this was just published in Epidemiology and Psychiatric Services. And we found that there were relatively high rates of depression and anxiety in a lot of the places, relatively modest rates of PTSD, about 5%, 7% overall, and relatively high rates in some communities of alcohol use. Again, keeping the history piece in mind, we want to be cautious attributing all of this to the earthquake, but it gives us a sense of what the needs are, at least pointing out that depression, anxiety, and alcohol are very important to measure. And this was, just to clarify, 3 months after the earthquake, so this wasn't in the acute stress period of 1 month. The next part was to make sure, and this is what WHO recommends, that there was coordination with the all of the other UN bodies, so that with any other organization, we had to provide weekly reports, weekly meetings, to make sure that everybody wasn't jumping on each other's toes in the response. And then if we think back to that IASC pyramid, there were different types of services. So some very modest psychosocial services to normalize kids' experiences. The boy I showed at the beginning, Puru's son, took part in some of these. A lot of psychological first aid. Everybody wanted to get trained on psychological first aid and then go out and support people in their community, people in the rural villages. Then, remembering the lessons learned from the CIDT, we modified it and created a post-earthquake CIDT. So rather than saying we're going to have to go out and screen everybody for PTSD, can we use this vignette-based tool to help get people into care who might be a little bit more severely affected? And the other part of it, relatively quickly, was to do a training. MHGAP, Humanitarian Intervention Guide, I mentioned earlier, had just been released. So we got together 14 psychiatrists for a week and trained them as future trainers and supervisors so they could then go out to all of the earthquake-affected districts, train primary care workers, and then provide supervision. This was, after almost 20 years of working in Nepal, a really incredible experience, because when I started, I think there were fewer than 14 psychiatrists. So to have 14 all in the same room, all motivated, all dedicated to go out and do this was really incredible. A key piece here was that they said to us, this was about 2 months after the earthquake, they said, you know, we're seeing this in terms of our clinical practice. We're going out to the villages that are affected. We have primary care workers. And the vast majority of what we're seeing are not new psychiatric cases. These are individuals who had a diagnosis before and now it's got worse, or everybody in the community thought they had a problem and now things are getting much worse. And so what we talked about with them, you know, we think here about the idea of diagnostic overshadowing, right? That somebody who has a physical illness, who has a mental illness, comes in with a physical problem and we immediately jump to the physical. So the framing that was helpful for us was the idea of trauma diagnostic overshadowing, that we jump to the trauma first and we ignore everything else that's going on. So we really tried to gear their training for the primary care workers about the idea of trauma diagnostic overshadowing. Don't jump to PTSD immediately. Look at the other things that are available, because those might be more treatable given the resources that you have. And this is, again, the idea of you need a clinical history beyond that predates just the traumatic event. And here's our slightly complicated but somewhat effective supervision system, where you had the psychiatrists, and then the psychiatrists were getting supervised by myself and others at a distance to be able to provide their supervision. And the other part of it, as I said in the beginning, was developing psychoeducation tools that weren't going to be stigmatizing. If everybody thought that their brain mind was broken, there's going to be self-stigma, family stigma, so we framed all of this traumatic response around the ideas of heart-mind problems, not brain-mind problems. The other thing was there was anecdotal reports of increased suicides, especially among students. So a lot of students who were about to take their school leaving certificate exam or their high school graduation exam, who weren't able to do it, or the following year were supposed to take it, where they couldn't study, they couldn't perform well, and so taking pesticides or even hanging attempts. So what we did was we adapted our adult DBT to do a school-based DBT in Sanku, one of the most devastated communities. And then the other part of it was, as IMC came in, as the Red Cross came in, as UNICEF came in, we said, you can't just train every single person in every community and then go away and assume this is going to work. We have this existing tool, this common factors tool. Can we make this standardized in all of the trainings that are going on for non-specialists delivering post-earthquake services? So many of the organizations adopted this as well. So as you can see, we're able to kind of map across most of the IASC pyramid based not just on what we did in the 3 months afterwards, but that 20 years of work leading up to it. So this gives you a sense just from TPO's side, but there are many other organizations that are doing this. We were able to serve 127,000 unique individuals over the past year. Now, many of these have had, you know, multiple sessions. This is not just visits, but this is the number of unique individuals treated. So lastly, I just want to keep the idea of society in mind and how framing this stuff is very important, and not just having individual-based treatments. The one thing we found that many Nepalis did after the earthquake that they found very therapeutic was called a bhumi puja. Bhumi basically means ground or earth, and puja is like a worship or a prayer ceremony. So individuals will get together and worship the earth to try and appease it, hopefully have no more aftershocks, no more big earthquakes. And when people described it to us, they said the most important part was just being together with other people, to be all there together, working together, wanting to heal together, feeling that there was hope, that there was worth doing something. And so we wanted to make sure that we promoted these types of activities. Other things were like, even though houses were destroyed, people wanted to come together and rebuild a temple or rebuild a stupa. Because the idea is, if we can have this to worship, I don't mind sleeping in my tent, but I need that place to worship. So doing these things as collective activities were very important. So we wanted to make sure that we didn't have an overly biomedical model and ignore that these things could also have a lot of benefit. So this is actually, this young boy here, Ramesh, is a child soldier I met very early on in my work. But his work really, but his comments to me came back up as we were doing the earthquake response. So we were asking Ramesh about these child soldier reintegration programs and, you know, how he would know if our program were effective. You know, do you have less nightmares now? Are you able to concentrate in school? And Ramesh said to me, there are three things that will tell me if your intervention is effective. The first is, after I go through it, after my friends go through it, that we'll actually have the desire to help other people. We know we're better if we want to help others. He said, the second thing is, I'll know your intervention is effective if I actually have the opportunity to put that into action. I can have the desire, but if there's no way for me to actually enact that, I'm just going to get frustrated, we're all going to get frustrated, and maybe even have worse outcomes. And the third is, I will know this is a good intervention if afterwards I have that desire, the opportunity, and that I actually want to help all people equally. It's no good if I go through this and I get better and I only want to help my parents or my neighbor or my best friend. He said, real collective healing is that all people want to help one another. So if you can do those three things, I'll tell your donor that you had a very successful program. But this was really important for us in terms of thinking about everything that we did. The idea wasn't to come in and passively deliver services. We had spent 20 years building up local resources. The earthquake was just as important to do that in the short-term process of a three-month period. So really enabling as many people as possible to be able to help others. And there's increasing evidence from positive psychology about this idea of eudaimonia. So we think of hedonia, right, the pleasure we get from self-gratification. Eudaimonia is the idea of the pleasure, the positive response from helping others, caring for others. And we actually did a study with our child soldiers showing that these eudaimonic scales are associated with higher gene activation of antiviral activity and lower gene activation of inflammatory activity. So there are these salutogenic effects of helping other people. So we wanted to make sure that our program had that embedded as a core mission. So where does that bring us? So we have 20 years of providing these different programs. We're able to really integrate a lot of what we've done before into the earthquake to be able to reach over 100,000 people. And we've also seen benefits in terms of long-term policy change. Finally, WHO now has a mental health focal person that's present. Seeing that we had the materials, the resources, the energy to do these things, they've appointed a full-time person. After 20 years of sitting stagnant, national mental health policy is now being reviewed to be rewritten and reinstated. And I think most impressively is that we have spent the past 10 years, especially with our primary care integration program, trying to get the government to change what drugs are available in the community. You can have a decent training, but if the right drugs aren't there, how is that actually going to be enacted? So almost all this training happens at the healthcare, at the health post level. So as you can see, if you're training for treatment of depression, anxiety, PTSD, psychosis, schizophrenia, are any of the drugs that you need there? And what's the one drug that you don't want to give somebody with PTSD? Oh, it's there. Great. Perfect. So we had to do a lot of work around, well, all those drugs that you don't have, those you should be using, but the one drug that's easily there available, you should not be using. So finally, we actually got the International Medical Corps that typically just comes in and pays for helicopters and trainings and things like that to pay for a whole series of workshops with the government to whom we've been lobbying for the past, you know, 5-6 years. Thanks to this, we now have all of these medicines available free of charge through the government at the healthcare facilities. Xanax is still there, but at least you got the other ones too. So this was a huge relief. And the big difference is not just making them available there, but getting away from, you know, the very first antipsychotic medicine and lots of side effects to something that's going to be a little bit more palatable and helpful for the population. So three ideas from this idea of building back better. One is just that this has to be an iterative process between emergency responses and health system strengthening. And you have to jockey back and forth and be thinking about one as you do the other. The second is, how can you measure the increase in human capacity and in policy guidance with each step? Are you generating new materials? Are you getting the government to put these things into legislation? And what new human resources are available to actually deliver these services? And then another, from a very conceptual level, is that people have a history. Communities have a history, nations have a history. That cannot be neglected just in the expediency of responding to a traumatic event. The second is how somebody views the world, the meaning this has for them, their community, is very important. And sometimes engaging in treatment can be more damaging than not if it's too stigmatizing. And then lastly, when we think about collective traumatic events, collective healing needs to be a part of that process. So I want to show you a picture of the boy I showed at the beginning, the Puru son. Went through our program, like Star Wars, so clearly our intervention was effective, but doing very well, mother doing very well, back in school now. And there are many, many cases just like that. And then I just want to leave you with kind of these thoughts from Ramesh, the child soldier. I think we in global mental health, or in the mental health field in general, we're going to know that we're doing the right thing if we find that in our students, in our colleagues, in our patients, in the patients' families, in our global collaborators, that there is a desire to continue to stay engaged, to be hopeful about mental health services, mental health advocacy. The second is, are we actually creating opportunities for evidence-based delivery of care? If we can't actually make evidence-based care available, then what, you know, good is that desire? And then lastly is this idea of equity. We know we're going to be doing things right if people in the mental health system, whether it's nationally, whether it's globally, want this to be available to everyone in their community. We really believe at TPO, and you make this one of my core philosophies, is everybody should have equal access to mental health care. And if you are interested, you should also have access to gaining the skills and the knowledge to be a mental health care provider. And so that's what we've spent the past 20 years doing in Nepal. And thank you very much for your time.